everyone. Welcome to the Good Governance Academy within the EU-funded project, A Sustainable Urban Marketplace, Participatory Urban Governance for Safe, Green and Inclusive Fresh Market Management in Indonesia. Today we will talk about waste segregation, fractioning and recycling. Recycling is the process of collecting, sorting, processing, and converting into new products, materials that would otherwise be thrown away as waste. Besides the reduction of waste, recycling is one of the most effective ways to save the environment, and it is one of the most environmentally friendly actions a person can take. It reduces pollution and carbon footprint by preventing waste from being burned or landfilled, where it would release harmful pollutants, toxins, and greenhouse gases into the environment. It reduces the need to extract new raw materials, the process which requires a lot of energy and also leaves a heavy carbon footprint. Recycling also helps to save money by reducing waste disposal and production costs, providing a source of income from sales of recycled materials, and creating new jobs. There are several types of recycling. Material recycling involves recycling materials such as paper, plastic, metal, glass, into new materials and products. Chemical recycling, which is also called advanced recycling, converts polymeric waste plastics by changing the chemical structure to produce substances that are used for as products or as raw materials for the manufacturing. Biological recycling or composting involves the recycling of organic waste such as food scraps, yard trimmings, and other biodegradable materials into compost, which can be used as a fertilizer. Electronic and electric waste recycling involves the recycling of computers, smartphones, and other electronic devices and their parts into new products or raw materials. There is also upcycling and downcycling. Both downcycling and upcycling start with the original used products broken down and their basic elements separated. The main difference is that with downcycling, the products are created as a result are generally of lower value than the original products, and with upcycling the final products have a higher value. Recycling the materials over and over again, however, can lead to it losing its quality completely, so it becomes unusable, which is why upcycling is a more desirable option. The reason for choosing downcycling is simple. Certain materials cannot preserve or increase their value, but completely discarding them would be a waste of money and resources and bad for the environment. A lot of examples of downcycling can be found in the construction sector. For example, crushed cement from buildings or glass is used to develop road infrastructure. Cleaning rags or mops can be made from used textiles. Plastic and paper are also usually downcycled into lower grade materials. Upcycling involves innovation and creativity, as well as a commitment to sustainability and waste reduction. It can also be a way to support local artisans and businesses, because many upcycling projects are handmade and require specialized skills. Examples of upcycling include creating valuable art pieces out of recycled materials, turning old clothes into new fashionable items, old furniture into new pieces, or creating jewelry from electronic waste. Here you can see how plastic packaging can be upcycled into new shopping bags. You can follow the link copied in the description section below for the instructions in Indonesian. Each type of recycling has its own benefits and challenges, and choosing the right type of recycling depends on the materials being recycled and the goals of the recycling program. But before products or materials can be recycled, they must be segregated. Waste segregation is a process of sorting and separating waste into fractions for further processing and disposal. Segregation makes waste cheaper to manage as it facilitates reuse, redesign, and recycling. It helps to protect the environment and human health by ensuring proper disposal of polluting and hazardous waste. It helps to combat the climate change by reducing the carbon footprint, which is much higher for unsegregated waste. In Poland and other EU countries, segregating waste at source, where it's generated, is required by law. The lack of segregation at source causes a range of problems. When different types of waste are mixed together, it can contaminate recyclable materials, making them unsuitable for recycling, or increasing the cost and time required for sorting and processing the materials, thus reducing the efficiency of the recycling process and causing more waste to be sent to landfills. For example, if food waste is mixed with paper or plastic recyclables, it can make all these materials too contaminated to be processed. Lack of segregation at source also creates health and safety hazards for waste workers, as they may come into contact with hazardous materials or encounter sharp or dangerous objects. Improper segregation can contribute to environmental pollution, as hazardous materials or chemicals can leak into the environment, contaminating soil, water, and air. Overall, proper segregation at source is essential for efficient and effective waste management and recycling. In Poland, the waste segregation system has been in force since 2013, but it was not uniform at the beginning. Each municipality could segregate in a different way. But since 2017, the new regulation of the Ministry of the Environment introduced the current uniform waste segregation system, which is designed to promote sustainable waste management practices and increase recycling rates in Poland. Now all households, offices, and businesses are obliged to segregate waste into the following fractions: paper and cardboard. This fraction includes all kinds of paper waste, including newspapers, magazines, office paper, cardboard packaging, and cardboard boxes. Glass, this includes all kind of glass waste, including bottles, jars, and other glass containers. Metal, it includes all kinds of metal waste, including steel cans, aluminium cans, and other metal packaging. Plastics, includes all kind of plastic waste, including plastic packaging, bottles, and bags. Biowaste includes all kinds of organic waste, including food waste, garden waste, and other biodegradable waste. Mixed municipal waste, this is all the residual waste that cannot be sorted into any other category, such as diapers, sanitary waste, and non-recyclable plastic items. In addition to these waste fractions, the regulation also requires segregation of all hazardous waste, including batteries, electronic waste, fluorescent lamps, outdated medicines, and other hazardous materials. These materials must be collected separately and disposed in a safe and environmentally friendly way. Here are some examples of urban waste fractions according to the materials properties. Food and kitchen waste, paper and cardboard, clear or colored glass. Plastics can be separated by different types according to quality, density, or color of the material. Aluminium cans, scrap metal, textiles, rubber, furniture, cooking oils, waste from electronic and electric equipment. Hazardous waste fractions can include batteries, fluorescent tubes, medicines, X-rays, and construction and demolition waste. And here is an example of how different waste fractions can be processed and used for the production of compost, raw materials, refuse-derived fuel and biogas, or incinerated to generate electricity. The introduction of waste generation can face numerous challenges. Many people may not be aware of the benefits of waste segregation or may not know how to properly segregate their waste. Some people may resist changes to their current waste management practices or may find it inconvenient to separate their waste. This can be particularly challenging in areas where waste segregation is not already a common practice. Education and awareness campaigns may be necessary to promote understanding and public participation in waste segregation programs. Inconsistencies in regulations and guidelines between different municipalities or regions, as well as the lack of policy instruments or incentives for waste segregation at source, can create confusion and make it difficult to implement a uniform waste segregation program. Underdeveloped local market for recycled materials can also hamper the progress. The implementation of waste segregation may require new infrastructure and logistical support, such as separate collection bins, waste processing and recycling facilities, and transportation systems. This can be costly and time-consuming to establish. In some cases, the introduction of waste segregation programs can lead to an increase in illegal dumping as people attempt to avoid the inconvenience of proper waste disposal. The implementation of a waste segregation program can also be hampered by high cost, particularly in areas with limited resources or funding. Overall, the introduction of waste segregation requires careful planning, taking into account the local specifics, as well as public education and good communication with the local communities to overcome the challenges and promote effective and sustainable waste management practices. Now we will examine different countries' experience in implementation of recycling and segregation schemes. Redone is an American fashion company launched in 2014 with a simple idea of taking the old and making it new again. This inherently sustainable goal has pivoted the fashion industry towards a more responsible future. Since launch, Redone has prevented over 200,000 pieces of cloth from being disposed in landfills. It reconstructed them into luxury designer clothes, which sell for quite a lot of money. Here you can see some of the examples of their products. In 2020, Hong Kong introduced the Greens Smart Card to facilitate segregation and encourage people to use the community recycling facilities. Members of the public bringing over 2 kilos of recyclables to the community recycling network can earn greens, which can be exchanged for small gifts. In 2008, the city council in Bergen in Norway decided that all future waste collection in the historic city center should shift from bins and containers to underground pipes. This was done because the area has a lot of old wooden houses and the roads are very narrow. Regular waste collection was creating fire hazards as well as traffic and parking problems for waste collectors. Bergen was one of the first in the world to build an underground pipe system to collect waste from the entire city center. The system covers several square kilometers and more than 12,000 households. After the construction is complete, a network of pipes will be over 7.5 kilometers long. Users have to use ID chips to access the allocated inlets. The inlets are multifunctional. Users from private households, business customers, and passers-by can use 3 different hatches to dispose different volumes of segregated waste: household waste, paper, cardboard, and plastic. The facility works 24 hours a day, all year around. A project of this magnitude is quite expensive and requires innovative experimental technology. The next example is from the Spanish city of Ibiza. Ibiza updated its waste collection service in 2016, and now an external company provides the new waste collection service. That company assigns part of its income to finance the awareness-raising campaigns. The first campaign was targeting social media users and consisted of short and clear messages about good practices in waste collection and the importance of keeping the island's roads and beaches clean. They also printed brochures for local businesses, and environmental educators distributed and explained them. Posters for residents were also distributed by a company which was recruited by the town hall. Here you can see how such posters look. The Greek island of Crete launched an optimized collection system for used cooking oil, which combines the use of smart sensors and real-time monitoring through a web-based platform. Improperly disposed used cooking oil blocks the drainage, raises energy consumption for wastewater treatment, and is highly toxic to sea, rivers, and other ecosystems. Recycling used cooking oil to biodiesel is a sustainable alternative to exploit this problematic waste. The system includes 30 collection points with smart bins and a web-based platform which allows real-time monitoring and signaling when the bins are full, which allows also the optimization of the waste collector's routes. This boosts the efficiency of waste collection and lowers operational costs. Fewer collection trips means lower fuel consumption and lower greenhouse gas emissions. Awareness campaigns and communication activities explaining the local residents about the system increase the recycling rate of used cooking oil and improves its proper disposal. A small-scale biodiesel production unit was built, which demonstrates how the used cooking oil is transformed into a clean fuel. The whole system costed about 40,000 euros, plus the costs of installation and maintenance. When looking for a better solution to textile waste disposal, the Belgian city of Antwerp made a concession agreement with an alliance of 5 organizations called The Collection. Its objectives were to organize clearly communicated and structured collection of used textiles and achieve the maximum level of local reuse by facilitating the collection and sale of reusable textiles. The collection received the right to collect all textile waste in the city. It is done from households directly by appointment through special containers in recycling parks and through a network of delivery points. Once the agreement was made, the cost for the city of Antwerp is zero. All the collection, sorting and selling of used clothes is done by the collection. The next example is from the Spanish city of Cordoba. In 4 years, they managed to achieve a 90% increase in compost production at composting sites, thanks to a better separation at source. The campaign promoting separate collection of bio-waste and composting had many elements. Bags of compost and information about the project were distributed in the streets and at other social points. Small vegetable gardens were established at schools where children could discover how useful is compost made from organic waste. The Eco Heroes Environmental Education Program was launched, teaching school children and local residents how to produce compost by themselves. It promotes the idea of organic waste being a useful resource. Within the Cordoba Recycla pilot project, smart containers were installed, which could identify their users through personal cards and award them with small presents, for example, cinema tickets for good segregation of waste. Students and residents had an opportunity to visit the recycling plant and waste treatment facility. It helps to raise awareness and promote good waste management practices. The budget allocated for the action is 30,000 euros a year, and it covers the awareness-raising events, public interventions to promote segregation, educational services, and contracts with different city organizations which support the initiative. When waste segregation started 30 years ago in the Polish city of Krakow, 700 igloo-type containers were installed throughout the city. Their main purpose was to educate local residents about waste segregation and recycling. It allowed separate collection of 4 fractions: paper and cardboard, plastic and metal, white glass, and colored glass. And the next example is from Indonesia. Together with the German Association Borda, the German NGO Atmosphere supports poor neighborhoods in Java to resolve the waste problem by themselves by running small decentralized material recycling facilities. This program is called KIPRA, Kita Pro Sampah. Plastics and glass are segregated and sold as raw materials for recycling, which helps financing the operation. Organic waste is composted using the bamboo aerator method, and compost is sold as fertilizer to the residents and farmers. The small amount of residue waste is brought to landfill. To prevent the waste problem getting bigger in the future, Education of children is an important component of the KIPRA program. Children can learn at school about how inappropriate handling of household waste becomes a threat to health and to the environment, and how to collect and separate the trash correctly. It is done in a playful manner using theater and songs. Children also practice reusing plastic. They are making plant pots out of plastic bottles, which are then placed in the school's vertical gardens. Thank you very much for your attention. You can find the useful links from this presentation in the description. If you have any comments or questions, please write in the comment section below.